broadcasting from Silicon Valley, California. This is Conversations with Jennylyn.
You're watching Conversations with Jennylyn, and today I feel blessed, lucky, privileged, honored, and I could go on because my guest is the very first Archbishop ever that I've interviewed, and he is Archbishop Charles Jason Gordon, and he is the Archbishop in Trinidad and Tobago. Archbishop, welcome to Conversations with Jennylyn.
It's great to be here with you, Jennylyn.
I am so grateful that you could spend this time with me. I want you to know that 10 years ago, I started my television show, and I always began everything in my life with God. And
Amen.
At the time, I couldn't find a priest available on the day I was going to debut my show. So I got two nuns, and they are two great friends. And guess what? My very first show ever was nominated for an award. I was among three finalists, although I didn't win.
Wow.
I won an award as a first runner-up. So, enough.
Wow, that's great. That's great.
That's what happens when you do it with God, right?
Congratulations, yes.
Thank you. And 10 years going, now I'm interviewing you.
There we are.
So tell me what it's like to be the Archbishop in Trinidad and Tobago, and are you a native of Trinidad and Tobago?
Yeah, I was born in Trinidad and Tobago. Grew up in Woodbrook, which is a little community, just a suburb of Port of Spain. I've spent most of my life here. I've had brief spells where I lived out. At between 1.5 and 3 years old, my father was studying in England. And so we lived in England for that time. I did my master's work in Leuven, Belgium. So I lived in Belgium for 2 years, and I did my doctoral work in London at Heathrow College. So I lived 4 years there. And then I've been the bishop in St. Vincent and the Grenadines and Barbados from 2011 to 2017. So I spent some time out during that time. But apart from that, I've lived in Trinidad all my life.
Well, I've lived in Trinidad, and some amazing people live there, and it's such a beautiful island. I think they're very lucky to have you as their archbishop. I am especially grateful for this time with you because during this COVID-19 pandemic, where so many people are fearful, so many people are concerned, so many norms are being changed and new standards are being set. What do you have to say to people watching this show that are fearful?
You know, most of our life, we live believing that our little world, in the way that we live it, with the routines that we set, with the parameters that we set, that we believe that that's how life should be. And the truth is, it's an illusion, because nobody's guaranteed us anything at all. And nobody's guaranteed us later today, tomorrow, anything else after that. And so we should really be living our life where each day is an incredible adventure. And each day is an adventure to discover again and again how we can grow and become a better version of ourselves. And if we live that way every day, then a COVID day is no different from a pre-COVID day, because in the COVID day, we are also exploring in every day how we can become a better version of ourselves. And that means every opportunity that comes our way, we are seeking it out, using it, and maximizing it for growth.
That answer. I love that, Archbishop. I think as humans, we become creatures of habit. And even
if
our habits are not serving us, because it's so difficult to branch out and do something new, we remain in these little boxes that most people aren't even serving us.
And sometimes they're very destructive. Like, think before COVID, people were living manic lives from early morning till late night, no time, no creativity, no time to think, chasing something constantly. What was the purpose of all of it? What was its real purpose? Did it really serve to make us a better human being? Did it serve our families? Did it serve our loved ones? Did it connect us deeply to living and the purpose of our life? Did it connect us to our vocation and how God has called us to be in this world and to be a contribution to other people? You know, and many times you could look at it and you say, well, I'm really not sure what all of that past space was about. So we've had some time where we've been locked down for a while. Now we've had a time to reflect, to think, to be with ourselves, to be able to think again what kind of life we really want, to have some leisure time where we could have done, we could do some of the things we've always wanted to do, some movies, some music, some books, some things that we've had on our list for the longest while and never got to. And now all of a sudden we're living and a little microbe has done that to us. But we didn't have the courage to stop and say, you know something, I am going to live regardless. And if we had done that, then the microbe or our regular life, what would be the difference? Because we'd be making the contribution we're making, we'd be growing, and we'd be doing the things that connect us to really living and living deep.
I agree with you. And you know, the thing when you said the microbe that was crossing my mind, and I've mentioned this in previous interviews, I've met so many people in my life, and when I tell them about God and the impact he's had on my life and the difference with when I've deviated from the path I know I should be on, the difference that I experienced in my life, they look at me like, you're crazy. How can you believe in a God you do not see? But as you're saying, a microbe is controlling everyone and everything in the world right now.
That's right. And you can't see the microbe with your eye.
Exactly.
But you believe it's there.
Yes.
Neither can you see God, but you better believe that God is there too. And if we believe that God is there, then we also have to believe that this time of the shutdown and the challenge, the slow, the all of it, that this is also part of God's incredible plan, and that God will use everything to good for those who love, trust, and serve him. And therefore, if we really love, trust, and serve God, then this could never be a terrible time. It's a difficult time. It's a challenging time. Many people are out of work. Many people are on a breadline. Many people are not having enough. But many people are learning how to share and how to be resilient and how to care for a neighbor and how to reach out to a brother or sister. And this heartwarming solidarity is emerging in humanity again. And it's incredible. It's really incredible. And the other thing is that we human beings are really strange, you know. We only learn by suffering. And that's the most funny thing about us. Unless we go through a period of suffering, we don't learn and we don't evolve. And that means that we stay capped right where we were. And that glass ceiling that was over our head, where we were believing that we were really in control of our life. We had our little rituals that made us feel safe. We had our little thing that we made us feel connected. All that's rubbish. It's all rubbish. Because a little microbe has changed your ritual, has changed your rhythm, has changed your routine, has changed your focus, has changed everything. And therefore, we know that what we construct our life to be is really not as secure as we think it is. And therefore, I would say, I prefer to fall like David, I prefer to fall in the hands of the living God than to fall in the hands of anything else. And so construct your life in a rhythm with God. And therefore, whatever comes your way on any given day, let it come.
I love it. Can we keep going? I wanted to ask you, in a world where dark and light are so much present at all times, in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic, it's like it's not bad enough, it's not rocking the world enough. We have the problem of racism, And I'm sure you've been seeing the news where another black man has been killed that shouldn't be dead today. As an Archbishop, what do you have to say to that? And what hope do we have for this ever-changing based on your leadership as a man of God?
You know, in our national anthem in Trinidad and Tobago, we have that beautiful line, "May every creed and race find an equal place."
I like that.
And then it ends, "May God bless our nation." Now, that sums up the heart of the thinking. When you can believe that another human being is lesser because of the color of their skin, because of their economic circumstance, because of whatever other accident that there might be, when you can believe that another human being is lesser because of whatever your little mind has contorted you to believe, I think that that's sick. It's an illness. It's really an illness that is at the very heart of a denial of truth, and at the very heart of a denial of reality, because the little microbe will infect that person the same way they're going to infect you, and the little microbe is giving their life as much challenge as giving your life, and the air we breathe has been given to both them and to you. The sunlight shines on both them and you. The rain falls on both them and you. And if you believe that somehow in your little contorted world that you have somehow become superior because of your gender, because of your age, because of your race, because of your education, because of your economic status, come on. Humanity's been around too long to know that that's foolishness. Because at the end of the day, we're all going to die. And when we die, we all going to face God. And no amount of money you've accumulated, or degrees, or education, or status that you have, or likes, or friends, can you take where you're going to go after you die? What you take is the depth and the quality of your soul. And the depth of the quality of your soul is judged by one single criteria. How do you treat those who are least and most vulnerable? And when you see how you treat those, that tells you something about you, about your depth, about your soul, about your capacity, and also about your civilization.
Right.
And so if your civilization is treating the most looked down upon in the most bizarre and foolish kinds of ways, it says something about the civilization. And if this is tolerated by people, and if this is allowed and acceptable by people, it says something about the civilization. You know, every human being, regardless of the exterior, external, regardless of what you put on, your clothes, your economy, your status, regardless of every human being comes down to be equal before God. And that equality is something that none of us can erase. We are equal in dignity before God. We might have different talents. We might have had a different start in life. We might have had advantages because we were born into a middle-class family, or this family, or that family, or disadvantage. But in terms of status, we are equal. And unless people are willing to accept that as a fact of human existence upon which we build the rest of civilization, we are going to be in trouble as civilization going forward. Because the whole thing of racism is really a thing of illness. Ignorance. Because, well, I'm saying illness. I'm trying to be charitable. I'm trying to say that the people who are racist are really prone to an illness. It's a mental illness, because it is an avoidance of what is absolutely true of the capacity of every single human being to flourish. I mean, we have enough examples of people of every race, culture, background, who have done amazing things for humanity. We have enough examples of that. For anybody in the 21st century to really believe the people of one color or one race are inferior only because of their color. No, 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 no. This is the 21st century. We're not living back in the day when we didn't know. We're living in a time where we have seen enough. And I would say that the explosions of racism within America are really a part of a sickness of the society. And it needs a healing. And the healing can't happen by violence and force. The healing has to happen by the recognition that there's something fundamentally wrong. And that every human being matters. And that's something that we have to work hard towards, because as long as people are allowed to get away with racism, institutionally, individually, in the system, and anyway, we will never be the society that we were created to be. And we will always fall short of the glory of God, and we will always fall short of what God intends for us. And that's why when people are both racist and claiming to be Christian, it sends an alarm bell off in my head, like you will not believe, because you can't hold these two together. You can't say you believe in Jesus Christ and you're going to discriminate against someone, because the whole gospel is based on one single commandment, and that's the commandment of love. Love one another as I have loved you. And what that means is that he gave himself up on the cross for love for us. He endured everything for love of us. And our love for our neighbor has to be a self-sacrificing love. It has to be a giving love. It has to be a love that puts the other first. That's how he loved us. And we can't say that he is our God and our master if we are living in a way totally contrary to the witness of his life.
Mm-hmm. Because if you cut any of us, it doesn't matter your ethnicity.
Blood is the same.
The blood is all red. It's the same red blood.
All the organs are the same. Mm-hmm. It works all in the same way. And give anyone an opportunity at education, and they do as well. And they've had brilliant, in America, they've had brilliant people of African origin who have done incredible in every single sphere of life. So you can't keep believing that they are inferior when, in fact, they have demonstrated superiority in character, superiority in the way they treat other people, superiority in their conduct. You know, so if you want to look at superiority, let's look at conduct and character and start measuring what real superiority looks like.
I love it. Archbishop, you know, apart from the color thing and the prejudices that exist in the world, another great prejudice is religion.
Ah.
We've lost so many people because they didn't share the same philosophy that a certain particular denomination believed in. So they're killing them off. Can you do that? What do you think? What do you see as a solution for that, if any? Again, I guess, education again, I guess.
So, but it's part of the same sickness, okay? Uh-huh. It's one illness, many manifestations.
Uh-huh.
So, what I would say is that we human beings, we need somehow to find a way to make a difference between us and others. That's how we form identity. Identity is formed by the difference between us and others. And that's just normal human. So if you think of being in school as a child, there were groups. And you were part of this group as opposed to that group. Now, if we could then move on to say that this group and that group are equal, then there's no problem. But what we then do is try to create logic to define why our group is superior to the other group. Didn't you do that in school?
Yes, I did.
This is deeply ingrained in the human being.
Yes.
So we form our groups, then we create a logic to convince us and others that we are in fact superior to them. And then we go to the next level, where not only we have the logic that they're superior, we start acting towards them as if they are inferior. and we start now treating them in a manner that is less than humane and less than dignity.
Right.
And now we've gone to the next level. And if we go to the next level, we actually think we have a right to rid the earth of them. And that's when you go to the next level. This is true regardless of what we use to create the divisions between us. Okay? So let's start there. Let's go now to religion. My theory is that religion has not caused wars. My theory is that human beings have caused wars, and they use any logic they can to do so.
Mm-hmm. Good.
And religion is just one of the logics that they have used to cause a war. Because you know the face that launched a thousand ships, Helen of Troy. So they went to war for what reason? You know? So the reason that is given for the war is never the reason that is given for the war.
Right.
Even our most recent skirmishes over the last 50 years, every single one of them, the logic given for going into war was never the logic. There was always another reason beyond the reason given. So religion is used as a way of rationalizing war and has been used. But that's never been the logic. The logic is always deeper than that. And the logic is really is in the human's insecurity. And that's what we don't want to deal with. That the reason we have prejudice over another person is not because of them. It's because of my own insecurity.
Absolutely.
My own inadequacy and my own fear about what they will do to me. That's why we do the prejudice and that's why we do the war. So we launch the prejudice and we launch the war because of our own insecurity, our vulnerability, because we're not adequate in our own eyes. And we see ourselves as inadequate. If we felt that we were adequate, no one can threaten me. And no one could make me feel less than. And no one would I want to treat as less than, because if I am adequate in my own eyes, I have nothing that I need to do to make another person feel less than. In fact, if I'm adequate in my own eyes, I start to treat people in a way that they actually feel better than they feel in their own self. And they actually feel a sense of dignity, and they feel self-worth, and they feel as if somehow they are special and better. And that's what a human being who lives with the fullness inside of them does for another human being.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's most amazing. Now, the societies that have had the greatest wars and the most brutal of societies have not been through religion. And we have to deal with that. So when you look at what has happened in Russia, where officially there was no God, that was the most brutal of societies, China, yeah. Under different regimes over the last 1,000 years. And so we want to blame religion as the problem. Religion is not the problem. Religion is the false logic that has been used for the human insecurity that wants to be able to wage war on another human being.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I view it.
No,
because real religion actually causes us to build bonds with each other and makes ourselves at service to the other. Real religion looks for the most vulnerable and says, how can I serve you? Real religion looks for the most needy and says, how can I serve you? If you look at the Catholic Church throughout the world, Catholic Church is one of the greatest service organizations across the world. On a daily basis, the Catholic Church educates more people, serves more people, deals with more people in hospital, in hospice, in all kinds of care, drug rehab centers, takes care of more migrants and people on the edge of society than any other institution in the world. On a daily basis, when you see what the church does, you understand what the church is contributing back to humanity on a daily basis. When you understand that, you say, well, you know, okay, but then people use religion now to create their war and they spout their hatred when Jesus says, I have one commandment, which is love.
Mm-hmm.
That hatred can't be from Jesus.
Yes.
It's not true religion.
Mm-hmm.
It's not what Christ taught us.
Is there a way to teach people to agree to disagree and to recognize and respect the differences in each other? Because clearly God didn't create us all the same. But in making us different, that was not permission to judge the people who weren't like ourselves. So how do you think we could approach and try to instill that value in people, or is it possible?
Absolutely possible. Absolutely it is.
You think?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. So I could give you an example. In a much earlier time in my priesthood, I was a parish priest in a community that had six gangs in and around the community. And when I was appointed 2003, January, within a 5-week period, we had five murders in 6 weeks, within a 6-week period. And so I set out to meet the gangs and to listen, and to meet the leaders of the community and to listen. And started a conversation within the community, among the leadership in the community and among the gangs. And I went into each of the gangs and sat for hours and hours and hours and just listened and listened and listened. And then at a moment when a war was emerging, in fact, a war had emerged, they called me one night, the community called me and said, "Father, you better come. This thing is out of hand. They just started firing off a machine gun."
Oh, no.
So this machine gun was going off in the community. So I called the group that had the machine gun and I said, "Listen, I am coming through. So stop your fire. And I'm telling the other side to stop fire because I am coming. And if you shoot me, that's trouble. So let's stop the fire." And I called the other side and I told them the same thing. I said, "I am coming through. Stop fire. You know my car. You're going to see me. I'm there in 5 minutes." And I drove in and went up to the guys who had the machine gun and scolded them for their foolishness and how could they do this. And went to the other side and said, "Go to bed, stop this," and got them to disengage. The next morning I went up and I met with them. And then within a week, I pulled the four gangs that were at war into one meeting in one of my churches. And we then teased out the challenge. And what did it come down to? It came down to a sense of feeling disrespected by the other. That's what it came down to. That the other person didn't really respect them or showed signs of disrespect to them. And in the conversation that was a 4-way conversation that they mediated, not me, at the end of that conversation, there was a sense that, you know, we really don't need war and the community don't need war. And so let's step back from this war. And I said, okay, This is not peace. This is a truce. A truce means you stick on your side, you stick on your side, don't cross. Because if you say it's peace, somebody cross, somebody gets shot, it will escalate. So until we agree again later on, this is a truce. This has gone from red to orange. Hold your section. And that happened. And the murder rate.
Genius.
And the murder rate in the community came right down. Over a period of the next year and a half, 2 years, the murder rate went straight down. What was important was that human beings, when they're escalating a war, it's when they can't have face-to-face contact and when they can't express themselves and their emotions to the person that they're believing. When you bring them face-to-face and you start having real conversations, what then starts to happen is people recognize themselves in each other and start to have a feeling for the other and start to recognize that there's actually a bond between us. And then they realize that, you know, I can't kill you because you and I have so much in common. And the difference doesn't cause destruction. The difference becomes something that we work with. I'm not telling you about a theory that I read in a book. I'm telling you about an experience I had. So
wow.
I'll give you one more piece out of that. So within a month of that, the gang leaders agreed to peace. I signed with them and said, "We're going to have peace in this community." I had two police officers there with me in this meeting. Eh? And so it was a whole community.
I hope you had some law enforcement with you. You can't be that brave.
But these were police officers. One lived in the community. Both lived in the community, but they were both very active in the work that I was doing in the community.
Okay.
And because of that work, they had partnered with me and really started working with me. So 1 month later, a gun got fired off in the community. And this one of the lieutenants, now they're not the leader, there's a lieutenant, fired off a gun in the community. So when I heard about it, I went to him and said, what foolishness is this? Your leaders and myself have all agreed no gunfire. How could you dare to break the truce that we have agreed to? Well, Father, I said, well, how could you dare to do it? He said, well, I had to send them a message. I said, I had to do what? He said, yes, I had to send them a message. I said, wait, hold on a second. You fired a gun to send a message? He said, yes. I said, wait, you fired a gun to send a message? He said, yes. So I said, wait, you're trying to communicate to the other lieutenant a message, and that's why you use your gun? He said, yes. So what was the message? So he told me the message. I said, okay, now, how else could we communicate this message without using a gun?
Can you tell me the message?
Huh?
Can you share the message?
Yes, the message was that he was being disrespected and that he was not a little boy and you couldn't treat him that way. That was the message. That was the message.
Unbelievable.
So we then brainstormed. I said, okay, next time you ever send a message, why don't you call me? You have my cell number. Call me. And I will send the message for you without the gun. You see, you do that? I said, of course. So within a week, I got a call. I got a message. I sent the message. Got back a message, sent it back. This happened two or three times. And then once it happened, and I was with the other lieutenant, and I said, look, here's my phone. Your talk. Well, it was an all-out fracas. It just degenerated into nothing. I mean, cursing, my poor phone heard words that I never heard in my life before. I was saying, oh, God, have this phone. This poor phone.
Oh, my gosh.
3 days later, I saw the guy, and I said to him, what was that about? Y'all were talking. It was going good. And all of a sudden, what was that about? Godfather, I'm sorry, you know. But don't worry, we sort out our business. So what do you mean? He said, well, I was there on the site working, and I saw him up on top, and I said to him, you know, we really can't be like little boys having the father carry message between us. We're big men. Why we can't talk? And the other lieutenant said, well, I agree with you. He said, but I have my piece on me. He said, me too. So they all handed their guns to the person next to them. They walked, they met, they spoke face to face, and that was the day the war ended. It ended
that day.
It just ended that day. And from that day, those two guys actually would look for each other, hang out with each other, and the whole community went into peace on that day. The gun is a tool of communication. That's what I learned.
Amazing when it takes so many lives too.
But it is a tool of communication. Mm-hmm. It is communicating my insecurity that I don't know how to use words to communicate. It's communicating the sense that I feel threatened by you. It's communicating that I am not comfortable with how you're posturing or you're doing this or that. But it's a tool of communication. So by teaching them alternative ways to communicate, they no longer needed the gun to communicate their message. And by modeling for them communication, they actually got it and didn't need me to model communication with each other. And that is really at the heart of building peace in any community.
Hats off to you. We need to send you around the world. You are.
I've been up working in Trinidad.
Well, you know, you can train other people to be a mediator, a healthy mediator like yourself, because look at what you did. Now, I have so many questions, and the time just flies. I must commend you because you live in Trinidad. You guys are doing such a great job with COVID-19.
Yes, the government has been excellent.
Yes. How? What do you know today? What the death rate is and your contaminations? Do you know?
Right now, we have no one, no active cases.
Oh,
right now, I think our last death rate was 8. And I don't think it went up after that. Our government took the view really early on, lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
Take the bit of medicine, take it up front, lock it down, and let's evolve out of this in a way that makes some sense. And so our curve went up to 115 and then started to fall right back off again.
Amazing.
Because we never really had community spread. But because before the community spread really started, the government locked it up. And so we really, I mean, many of the big sites now are looking at Trinidad as one of the examples of how this thing could have been handled better. We didn't go into the crisis that y'all are into. Now we're opening back up, and that opening back up is going to take a lot of courage. And it's happening, and it's happening stage by stage. But the government did really brave measures, and then the citizenry followed and held and allowed. And so we have really gotten away from the worst of what could have befallen us. Now, 40 of our cases came from a cruise ship.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the cases came from away, but they were contained before they started spread in a community. Human to human contact.
That is wonderful. Our time has run out, but I'm not stopping this interview. I just love doing this with you. I love your energy. What do you love the most about being an archbishop?
You know, getting to serve people and getting to be for people something that allows hope to emerge every day. So during the COVID time, I celebrated Mass every day. And it's a television mass. There's no congregation. I had one person singing. I had one person reading and a television crew and me. And every day.
Woo-hoo!
And every day we had thousands and thousands of people who were participating in the mass, which allowed me to take people on a journey through Lent, through the Holy Week, through the Triduum, and through the Easter period. And that was an amazing opportunity and a real grace, a grace for me and a grace for the whole church. And that has been really a singular and a most wonderful opportunity and grace, because to awaken people spiritually to the truth of what we're actually living day to day, that we don't have the eyes to see, that's a grace. That's just pure, pure grace. And then in the midst of this, from the very beginning, I realized if we're shutting down society this drastically, we're going to have a lot of people who don't have food. So the week after we shut down the schools and the churches, I started planning for opening up food distribution. And by the time the society was calling for food distribution, we were ready and distributing food. First Living Water Community, and then all of our parishes. So we went, before COVID, we were distributing 4,000 hampers a month, and Living Water would have done about 1,000 or just over 1,000 a month. Then now we are up to about 20,000 a month, and Living Water about 5,000 a month. So we've gone from about 5,000 a month up to 25,000 a month in a very short period of time. So the government has asked the faith-based organizations to help, and they've given us some funding to do that. But many, 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 many people have contributed funding to this effort that allowed us to escalate our outreach to those most vulnerable in a very, very significant way. And that's also an incredible grace. While this was happening, we have the schools. Because we have 118 primary schools in Trinidad and Tobago, Catholic primary schools.
Okay.
118 in our diocese.
Wow, just Catholic.
And that's Catholic. That's Catholic. It's 25% of all the children in our in primary schools come to our schools. And our schools are Catholics, Muslim, Hindus, everybody. all religions, Christians, all religions come to our schools. So when this whole thing happened, the other piece I was doing was leading the schools to continue online learning as opposed to stopping. And so we went through a whole process of engagement of the IT teachers first to find the right tools. Then we got the principals and one or two of their teachers. And we had a conversation with all the principals in three different tranches. And the principals then had conversations with their people. And our schools are up and running for the most part. And doing fairly well for the most part. And other schools are floundering and they don't know what they're doing. One teacher might be teaching or two teachers, but there's no sense of a school. Because I believe that when a child has too long a period without formal learning, their brain actually starts atrophying.
Yes,
because they go then to soft entertainment by a television and a game machine, and they don't engage in constructive learning and stretching the brain to grow and develop and become better. And so I said, we have to keep our kids, because our schools are in some of the poorest neighborhoods in Trinidad. Huh?
Okay.
So my thing is, if I allow these kids in the poorest neighborhoods to stop learning, what will happen to them at the end of all of this is going to be crazy. So let's just keep going. And we have. So every week we print something for kids. So those who have no technology have print. We put together television shows on teaching all the age groups. So we have television, we have prints, we have television, we have internet, we have web-based, we have email, we have smartphone, we have pictures being sent, every technology possible.
Wonderful.
Our teachers are using, and they've been incredibly innovative.
Well, God bless you all. Archbishop, I have a request. I always end my shows, but I don't want the show to end, and I have to keep it within a certain number of minutes. Would you be willing to continue another session with me in the near future?
Sure.
Thank you so much. I will contact you. We will set it up. Because
okay.
You have such great inspiration, encouragement, and I can't wait to continue this interview. And I thank you so much for carving out the time to do this with me. And we will be continuing this interview very soon. And
thank
you for watching Conversations with Jennylyn. When a conversation is all you need to be inspired, like this wonderful Archbishop that I've just been interviewing. And keep your eyes open as we continue this interview very soon. Again, thank you, and I will see you next time.